ETFs are the sweatpants of investing. They're not particularly sexy, but they're easy and comfortable, and they get the job done. But if you've been hanging around in your sweatpants for too long, and you start feeling a little guilty after a while, you start to wonder if there's something more to legwear. So today, let's discuss the least effort options for you to up your investing game from conventional ETFs to more ethical, sustainable options with a real impact in the world. Hello, world! This is the Impact Investing Show, where we think and learn about how to save the world and improve the lives of all conscious creatures by acting today and investing into the future. I'm Lennart Schelter, welcome to the show. So first up, this is not financial advice. Always do your own research, make your own decisions, and come to your own conclusions. Don't just trust me, I'm a random dude on the internet. Evaluating companies costs time, especially if you don't just look at the financials, but also at the sustainability and the impacts of the companies. So another solution would be ETF investing. They offer a pre-selection and diversification of assets, but you have to check what's in these ETFs. What about the impact of the companies in your ETF? So let's check a famous example, the S&P 500 index, one of the most famous indices in the world. The oldest and largest ETF in the US is the Spider S&P 500, the famous ticker symbol SPY. It was launched in 1993 and currently manages around $316 billion in assets. That's around the size of the Walt Disney Company and even larger than Netflix. So the main criteria for inclusion of companies in the S&P 500 index is their market cap, and they need to be a US company. There are some minor criteria as well, like they need to be traded on the New York Stock Exchange or the NASDAQ and have to fulfill a certain minimum trading volume. So currently the S&P 500 concerns 505 companies. The top 10 look like this and are not surprisingly among the top 10 or largest companies in the world. There is Apple, of course, and Microsoft, then the rest of the FANG companies without Netflix, so Facebook, Amazon, and Alphabet A and C, which is just different kinds of Google stock. Tesla is a fairly recent addition to the index, along with Nvidia, and then the two finance behemoths, Berkshire and JP Morgan. But further down the line, the following companies are also included in the index. The, in my humble opinion, soon to be obsolete companies Ford, General Motors and ExxonMobil. The literal sugar water sellers Coca-Cola and Pepsi. Then Arms and Defense Corporation, Lockheed Martin, not to be confused with international arms dealers, and many animal products-focused companies like McDonald's, Tyson Foods, or Yum Brands, which is the parent company for KFC, Taco Bell, and Pizza Hut. Now, to see if there might be a problem with ETF investing, ask yourself, do you really want to invest in these companies? Another famous example is the MSCI World Index. It comprises of 1,583 companies from developed markets. That's already three times as many companies as the S&P 500. The MSCI World tracks companies from the US, but also Canada, Europe, Australia, and Japan. And there are more companies in there that you might not want to invest in. More, in my humble opinion, soon-to-be obsolete companies like Toyota, Daimler, or Shell. More wholesome food companies like Nestle and Unilever. And one of my personal favorites, the mining company Glencore. Just Google it if you're not familiar with what they do. So it's the same game with this ETF also. Ask yourself, do you really want to invest in these kinds of companies? If you do, the sweatpants of investing might just be your style. But if you don't, let's see how we can upgrade a little, shall we? Luckily, there are better options available for us, better indices and better ETFs. It's just as easy to invest in them, doesn't cost you extra. However, they are not a silver bullet, as we will see in a second. I picked two examples today, the S&P 500 Sustainability Screened Index and the MSCI ESG Indices Universe. ESG stands for Environmental, Social and Governance, which are three broad categories of criteria that go beyond just the financials of a company. Now, from the S&P website, we learn that the S&P 500 Sustainability Screened Index measures the performance of stocks in the S&P 500, excluding companies involved in controversial weapons, small arms, tobacco, and fossil fuels at specific involvement thresholds. The methodology goes as follows. We start with all the companies from the S&P 500, and then companies are excluded according to revenue thresholds. This means all companies that extract thermal coal are excluded. Companies that manufacture tobacco products are also excluded, along with companies that earn more than 10% of their revenue from retail or distribution of tobacco products. Finally, companies that manufacture assault weapons and/or small arms are also excluded. So now, what's the difference between the conventional ETF version and the sustainability screened version? The conventional one holds 505 companies versus 458 companies in the sustainability screened version, so roughly 10% of companies are excluded. Let's compare the top 10, which make up 28% in the conventional index, so it's a significant chunk. On the left, you can see the conventional S&P 500. On the right, you see the sustainability screened index. As you can see, the top 10 companies are identical. So the difference in these two ETFs cannot be too great. This might be because only four sectors or areas of activities are excluded. But what about labor conditions, child labor, environmental pollution, or tax evasion? In my opinion, there are so many more sectors and issues that seem quite obvious to exclude. That's why these ETFs are no silver bullet, and you always have to check what's really in them and don't just trust the label because it has a fancy name or term. So let's see about the MSCI ESG indices and what they have to offer. MSCI offers an array of indices available based on the famous MSCI indexes like MSCI World, MSCI Emerging Markets, or the All Country World Index. There are far too many ESG indices to cover in this video, but here you can see the categories of indices that MSCI offers. Broadly speaking, they are becoming more strict from left to right. On the very left, you have the climate-specific indices, which focus on climate change in particular. Next up are indices which filter the companies according to ESG criteria. So on the very left, you take the same companies as the parent index, but you re-weight them according to their ESG rating. And it goes all the way to the right, where companies with a poor ESG rating are excluded altogether from the index. On the very right, the most strict indices are the impact investing indices that invest according to a defined aim. Now in this chart, you can see the number of excluded stocks on the x-axis and the ESG score on the y-axis. So this means the higher, the more strict the rules. And the further to the right, the smaller is the amount of included companies in the index. On the bottom left, you can see the standard conventional All Country World Index, which obviously has 100% coverage of the market because it's just the conventional version that includes all Country World Index companies. The different ESG versions are scattered across this range, and you can see on the top right, so the most strict and smallest index is the SRI version, the Social Responsibility Investing version, which covers 59% of the market. I want to show some details from the MSCI World SRI datasheet. So this index is based, of course, on the MSCI World Index, which in its conventional version holds 1,557 companies, whereas the SRI version only holds 373 companies. Comparing the top 10 also shows significant differences. In the conventional one, we have Apple and Microsoft, then Amazon, Facebook, Alphabet, Tesla, Nvidia, JP Morgan, and Johnson & Johnson, so very similar to the S&P 500. The SRI version of the MSCI World, however, looks very different. You start with Microsoft, then Tesla, Nvidia, Home Depot, ADML Holdings, Disney, Roche, Cisco, Coca-Cola, and finally Pepsi. So the SRI methodology deems these large tech companies to mostly be unfit for the index, unlike the S&P 500 Sustainability Screened Index. Apple is out, Amazon is out, Facebook is out, Google is out, and the top players are then Microsoft, Tesla, and Nvidia, which is the only overlap between the top 10 from the conventional and the SRI version. Regarding performance, we can see this chart here, comparing the SRI with the conventional version. And over the last 14 years, the SRI version actually outperformed the conventional one. In fact, since 2008, the SRI version delivered better returns in 8 out of the 13 years until 2020. The annualized returns for the SRI version are 7.19%, whereas the conventional version only achieved 6.21% since 2007. So now we've seen two examples of ESG-filtered versions of prominent conventional indices, and for some of these, there are vast differences, but they are not a panacea for sustainable investing. Do your own research and clarify your own standards, and as always, this is not financial advice. Sustainable investing and ESG ETFs are growing rapidly, and I think there are three main reasons. First up, the world is changing. Climate change is real, and so are many other problems, and investors don't just want to ignore them anymore. Secondly, there is a new generation of investors. Young people in particular are much more keen on solving these problems instead of just maximizing returns. And these people are entering the markets at massive rates right now. And finally, there is better data and technology for more meaningful insights into these sectors. We can monitor things much better, and it's much harder to hide these problems and questionable business practices from companies. So to summarize, conventional ETFs are a great start to investing, but they invest without ethical concerns. So if you're interested in that, try to focus on the ESG-filtered versions of your favorite indices and ETFs, as they offer a very comfortable and easy alternative to level up your investment game. However, they are not a silver bullet, as we discussed in this video, and they still have quite relaxed criteria in many areas. But they are certainly better than nothing. If you want more impact, more sustainability, I would suggest you focus on specific sectors that can deliver just that. On this channel, my suggestion, as you all know, would be cellular agriculture. So if you're interested in that, check out one of my other videos and stick around for future ones as well. See you in the next one.